What's going on, guys? It's Simo. So today I'm bringing to you my top 5 meta decks for the March 2020 format. With so many tournaments coming up like Regionals, YCS Brazil for all you South American players, as well as YCS Charlotte taking place at the end of the month. It's the last month of Master Rule 4. Isn't that crazy? Master Rule 5 is right around the corner, but I want to make sure you guys are best equipped to go into these events knowing what the best decks are and what they are capable of. So without further ado, let's go ahead and get right into it. Kicking things off with number 5. We have a deck that kind of came out of nowhere, but is looking to be one of the front runners of the format, and that is Dinosaur. Yes, Dinosaur being a very potent threat in the current metagame, kind of just because of how it matches up with all of the other top tier decks. This is probably going to be the only going second deck you're going to see in this top five, although you could argue that one or two of the other decks could have a going second variant, but this deck is built on going second. Being able to play cards like Evenly Matched, like Lightning Storm, like Mystic Mine can just win games out of nowhere, and also you have the fact that the Dinosaurs are so capable of pushing through big boards. When you have cards like Ultimate Conductor Tyranno, you can even have stuff like Pentastag to be able to get the piercing damage through, Dugarez to boost the Tyranno up to 7,000 attack. There's so many cool things that you can do with Dinosaur that I definitely think it is a very devastating threat in the meta. We've already seen that Dinosaur has been able to get multiple consistent top cuts over the past few months. It won YCS Las Vegas on the 3v3 2 of the three players on that team were playing the deck, and it's been able to just do well for the past several months. That I definitely think it's earned its spot in this list. It's not really a surprise that Dinosaur is up here because it's been a very solid rogue contender for some time, and even if you're going first, you have the option to go into stuff like True King of All Calamities, which a lot of decks really can't deal with, and you have the potential to rip cards out of your opponent's hand with cards like Trishula. This is going to be a very destructive force in the metagame, and don't be surprised if you run into a lot of Dinosaur because a lot of top players are playing it, so that's why I went ahead and gave Dinosaur my number 5 slot. But coming in at number 4, we have a deck that's actually gone through a lot of different adaptations over the last several formats, and even to this very day, it's still undergoing changes, and that's going to be Lunalight. So Lunalight is a combo deck that focuses on producing some pretty insane boards. I mean, it takes advantage of the fact that the Lunalight cards are so good at producing rank 4s, and there's so many powerful rank 4s you can choose from. I mean, you have stuff like Tornado Dragon for back row decks, Abyss Dweller for any graveyard reliant decks. You even have stuff like Time Thieves, and that's why I said that the deck continues to undergo adaptations, because Time Thieves are an integral part of the strategy, being able to trigger stuff like Psi Frame Lambda by being able to banish your Redoer at the end phase, search yourself a Psi Frame Gamma, and the fact that this deck is able to play Gamma, which is arguably one of the best hand traps of the format, kind of one of the best hand traps of all time, honestly, but the fact that your board can end on Lambda with Gamma in hand and a way to consistently get to that while also getting back the Redoer and doing a plethora of other plays on top of that, it's just a very potent and powerful thing. This is a combo deck. It's aiming to just build an incredibly powerful board, but even going second, because you have access to the fact that this deck is so capable of throwing its resources away because they so easily can recur themselves, when you have non-once per turn cards like Monster Reborn that are in the archetype that allow you to keep pushing through your opponent's resources, that is why this deck continues to see competitive success. Again, similar to Dinosaur, it's been able to top pretty much every YCS or major event of the past several months, and I gotta give credit where credit is due, and that's why I gave Lunalight my number 4 slot. But coming in at number 3, it's time to turn up the heat, because this deck hasn't really gone anywhere since its initial release last year, and that is Salamangreat. You'd think Salamangreat would incur some sort of hit with Mirage Stallion getting banned, with Gazelle getting hit to 1, and Salamangreat Circle getting hit to 1, but no, if anything, that actually forced players into a different way of thinking, and realize the deck's true potential, that it is one of the most recursive, powerful decks of the format, because yes, it's not able to make these explosive turn one boards. Typically, you're gonna be ending on stuff like a Sunlight Wolf and maybe like a counter trap like Salamangreat Roar or Salamangreat Rage pop for 2. That seems okay, but the fact is, if you can get past that turn one, Salamangreat becomes so recursive because you pretty much have everything set up in your graveyard, right? You have your Spinny, you have your Jaguar, you can usually get access to Falco with Gazelle recurred back to your hand, and then you can continuously build the same board over and over again. But the nice thing about Mirage Stallion being banned is that the deck isn't forced into playing fires, and that's really good because now you're seeing players start to experiment with different types of builds. I even played a Microcoder variant that takes advantage of the fact that you want to go into Transcode Talker, use the counter trap from that variant. You can check out that deck profile on my channel if you so wish. Much more consistency added with Microcoder as well. People are even playing stuff like Boreal Sword Dragon in the deck now as an OTK mechanism, just because, again, Mirage Stallion Scalios in here so you're not walked into fires, and Salamangreat can easily get 4 link material worth of monsters on the field, so you just summon a Boral Sword and can just OTK your opponent, which Salamangreat typically had some trouble doing before because it couldn't reach that 8,000 damage threshold, but now it can OTK with ease, combined with the fact that it's got all the tools to outgrind pretty much any deck in the format. It may be reliant on the graveyard, and that makes it a prime target for graveyard-based hate, but at the same time, it's kind of like this jack-of-all-trades deck. It can kind of deal with any particular deck in any given situation, and it handles a lot of the tier 2 and rogue decks very well. So for those reasons, a lot of people are sticking with Salamangreat just because it's kind of tried and true and it's really consistent at that. So that's why I gave Salamangreat my number 3 slot. But coming in at number 2, we probably have the newest deck of the format on this list, and that is Invoked Shaddoll. Now this is definitely due in part to the release of the Shaddoll structure deck that just came out last February at the time of recording this video, and man, did this change the game. Window is already an incredibly powerful card, right? We've seen that in previous formats with decks like Orcus wanting to incorporate Winda using like Instant Fusion and Dingyusu to protect it, just because a lot of decks can't natively out Winda because it has protection from destruction and you're limiting your opponent to only a single special summon. So why not just play native Shaddolls now that they have their new support out of the Shaddoll Showdown structure deck? And it's really proving true that a lot of the top decks actually do have a very difficult time dealing with Winda, and that Winda is going to be sticking around and you're able to produce multiple windows if they're even able to out the first. It's almost kind of like putting your opponent in check, to use a chess reference, because it puts them in this very precarious position that if they can't really out the window, they probably just lose the game, because if they can't set up, then on the Shaddoll Invoked player's turn, they can easily get rid of the window by doing something like Link Summoning, and then they're free to do whatever they want and they're not hindered by their own window. And it's very easy for this deck to OTK with all the fusion tools available when you have stuff like El Shaddoll Construct being at 3, which is insane. You also have the Invoked engine, which adds such a level of consistency to this deck that it's never seen before, being able to have access to more fusion spells, which is kind of like the biggest issue of Shaddoll in the past, was that if you couldn't access your fusion spells, it was going to be very difficult for you to play. But now you have access to cards like Mecha Buff for even more interruption and disruptive plays. You have Purgatrio to be able to pierce through all of your opponent's monsters and deal significant damage, making it even easier to OTK than it was before. You have follow-up plays on top of follow-up plays, and the deck has really proven that it is one of the top decks of the format. Again, if your deck does not have a plan for beating Winda, you really need to figure one out, because this is one of the most played decks of the format at the moment. It's seeing a lot of success, and for those reasons, that's why I gave Shaddoll Invoked my number 2 slot. Now, before we get to my number 1 pick, I did have an honorable mention, and that is Rocket Dragon Link. Now, this deck doesn't have the representation as some of the other decks might, but that doesn't take away from the fact that this deck is extraordinarily powerful. The fact that this deck can produce boards that are on a scale of some of the top decks for such a minor commitment of resources, I think is incredible. When your opponent's having to deal with stuff like Appaloosa, Borload, Savage Dragon, just cards that not really a lot of decks have ways to deal with, stuff like Silver Rocket Dragon, being able to snipe cards out of your opponent's extra deck, you have Unchained Abomination just destroying cards left and right, which is terrifying for rogue decks. I mean, the deck has tons of options. It can very easily OTK. We already know how good of a deck Dragon Link is, so do not underestimate the power of this deck. And if I were you, I would definitely learn at least the interactions of how the deck functions, so if you do come across it, even though it doesn't have the representation, you know the choke points and how to properly play against it. But that's gonna bring us to my number 1 meta deck of the March 2020 format. And if you haven't already figured it out, I'm going with good old Spiral. Now, when it comes to Spiral, some people might argue that Shaddoll Invoked might be the number 1 deck. Some people might argue that Salamangreat might be the number 1 deck, but I think when it comes to Spiral, you cannot argue with results. Spiral has consistently had the most representation of top cut of premier events for the past several months, ever since the introduction of Magician Souls. And when it comes down to it, even though Spiral is very good at doing the same thing over and over again, producing these absurdly powerful boards with stuff like Trigate Wizard, Appaloosa, Sleeper, being able to pop cards on your opponent's turn, you have Utility Wire to be able to like spin cards back to the top of your opponent's deck, you get to search a DD Crow for any of the graveyard based decks, and everything else that the deck is capable of doing, that's just like one example, then yes, you can see why this deck is one of the strongest decks of the format, because if that deck goes unopposed and uncontested when it comes to any form of disruption or hand traps, it's very difficult to find a deck that can beat it. And so you think when you're going the distance, as long as you can achieve that, you should be looking pretty good. And again, the results show that this is the case. There's also several variants going around. There's more of a pure variant. There's a scrap variant, which is really neat because for going second, you have access to cards like Scrap Wyvern to be able to start popping your opponent's cards, going off, and be able to OTK with ease. There's even a Pot of Extravagance variant that people are still messing around with, a little bit more on the expensive side because you have to run multiples of some of the expensive extra deck cards. But nonetheless, Spiral definitely deserves the number one slot. It's one of the most oppressive decks of the format. It's got the tools to deal with almost anything. And yes, while it does suffer from some consistency issues because you have to play all these different one-ofs that sometimes can clog your hand and you really can't do much with them, despite that, the deck is still able to persevere and is still able to consistently be the most represented top cut deck when it comes to all the premier events of the past several months. So keep in mind, Spiral is probably going to be the deck to beat even to this very day. People still main decking Droll and Lockbird specifically for their Spiral matchup, even if it may not necessarily be the best deck or best card for other matchups, but it just goes to show that people are respecting that deck enough to main deck a card like that, even though it may not be optimal in all your matches. So guys, that's going to go ahead and do it for my top five list. Let me know down in the comments what you guys think about your top picks for the March 2020 format. I'd really love to hear your thoughts. Thank you guys so much for watching the video. Be sure to like the video as always. Subscribe to the channel for more amazing Yu-Gi-Oh! Content. And if you found this video helpful, consider supporting me on Patreon or becoming a YouTube channel member. Because just by showing your support in any way that you can, you're investing in my ability to continue bringing you amazing Yu-Gi-Oh! Content. So thanks so much again, and we'll see you next time.